few weeks ago, somebody asked a question. The question was, how do you think like a Buddhist? And this is a very interesting question, very profound question, very natural question. We begin our practice and we hear words and we read words, and this idea of about thinking always comes up. And the Zen instructions about thinking are a little confusing. And we hear them and we read them and we say, what does this mean? What do they mean? The founder of the Soto school in Japan, Dogen, went to China and stayed a few years. And when he came back from China to Japan, the very first thing that he wrote was something called Zazenji, or Fukan Zazenji, which means the rule for Zazen, the rules for Zazen. And in Zazenji, he writes about the posture, the rules for sitting, sitting posture, and rules about our attitude. And he also wrote about what to do with the mind. Very briefly, he wrote about what to do with the mind. And what he said, kind of famous these days, he said, think, not thinking. How do you think, not thinking? Non-thinking. What does he mean by non-thinking? I don't know. Nobody can explain what he means. Nobody can explain specifically what he means by non-thinking, but we can illustrate. We can illustrate this teaching. So here's a story which I remember from many years ago, and I no longer remember the names of the individuals involved, and I can't find it in any of my books at home, but it's okay. The story remains. In some temple or monastery in China, the Roshi, the abbot, the master, is taking a nap. And one of his monks comes by, and the abbot wakes up and says, oh, I'm glad to see you. I just had a dream. I just had this wonderful dream. Let me tell you about it. And so he explains the dream. And he says, what do you think about that dream? And without a word, the monk gets up and goes away. And in a moment, comes back with a cup of tea for his teacher. A few minutes later, another monk comes by. And the teacher sees him and says, oh, I'm glad you came. I had this dream. Let me tell you about my dream. And again, he explains the dream. What do you think about my dream? And without a word, the second monk goes away and comes back, this time with a bowl of hot water and a towel so his teacher can wash himself, wash his face. And then the teacher says, the master says, I have the best disciples. When the abbot says, I have the best students, when I have the best disciples, he means they did not engage in words. They knew what to do without any dialogue at all. They knew what to do without words. They did not let words distract them. They didn't say, oh, Roshi, do you need anything? They knew what to do without words. They were not distracted from doing what needed to be done at that moment. And in particular, they didn't sit around and speculate about the meaning of the dream. How did they know what to do? How did they know how to respond to their teacher. The knowing did not come from a rational thought process. It came from another kind of process, something else going on. And this other process, this something else, is based on feeling, not thinking. Based on perception and passion and a knowing that goes deeper than thought. In a very crude way, we might say this process is much like a radar. Always seeking, always recognizing, and always discovering what's there and what needs to be looked at. In this process, the unthinking process, the process without thought, emphasizes relationships, emphasizes paying close attention to relationships, not letting words get in the way. Process that understands the unseen bonds between people. This is how they knew what to do. Here's another story, a more modern story. It's about my wife and me. A few weeks ago, we took a weekend and went for a little trip up in the wine country. Stayed overnight. And next morning, went to the coffee shop for breakfast. And during breakfast, I had finished my coffee in my cup, and I wanted more. And I drink with the right hand, and my right hand was next to the window. And the waitress goes back and forth on the left side. This way. So I wanted more coffee, and the waitress was going back and forth. And I didn't say anything. I simply took my coffee cup and put it on the left side, where she goes back and forth. And she went by once, then went back, and then came again, this time with the coffee pot, and filled the cup. And we had not exchanged a word. And both of these stories illustrate somebody knew what was needed. They recognized it without being asked or without asking. They knew what was missing to complete the picture. And they were motivated to complete the picture. They were attentive and they were motivated and they were taking everything in. In other words, they were motivated, both this waitress and those monks were motivated to serve the other. This non-thinking process that Dogen talks about is about serving. When we have this non-thinking mind, when we have an orientation towards serving and towards relationships, in the usual perception we have of separation between people, individual people and all separate, the appearance of separation diminishes when we have this non-thinking mind. And the hard lines that seem to exist between people become kind of fuzzy. In other words, our relationships and the way we are together no longer feel like we are all pieces in a jigsaw puzzle that we're trying to fit together, but that we are separate. When we have a non-thinking mind, We emphasize relationships and serving. We recognize our oneness and our cohesiveness. And this apparent separation starts to lose its meaning, so it becomes fuzzy. In other words, when we follow Dogen's teaching about non-thinking, we can feel who we are through our feeling with others. And then serving becomes very natural. And selflessness becomes very natural. So Buddhist thinking is not concerned about some kind of analytical process or rational process, and it's not concerned about success in everyday affairs, everyday activities. Buddhist thinking doesn't concern itself with succeeding in the things we do every day. The kind of success that people want in their daily life, financial success or gaining prestige, hitting a home run. Buddhist thinking is not involved with success in that way. That kind of success has to be pursued constantly in our daily life. Pursuit of things and the gaining of things and feeling successful through gaining these things. That kind of success comes in small increments through individual wins. Solve a problem, sell a product, gain some recognition. All these things, we feel successful when these things happen. And if our life is oriented towards those kinds of successes, we have to continually pursue those things. But Buddhist thinking is motivated by a different kind of success. The success that we feel when we have selfless relationships. Now, that kind of success, we don't need to pursue it. And it doesn't come in increments. It's continually present. So how do we find this kind of success? How do we implement non-thinking in our lives in this modern world? Our mind is not a set of algorithms, which is a kind of feeling we have these days, especially in Silicon Valley. Our mind is not a set of algorithms. Our mind is not a set of problem-solving tools. And our life is not about our life is not a process of choosing. Our life is our true life is not about choosing the correct block of code or the correct template to use in a given situation. You know, the kind of thing we could activate and use in the constantly changing relationships in life. The true mind is not so neat. It's not nearly so neat. The true mind is kind of messy. the true mind, our true mind, does not work so systematically. Our mind works through ideas and passions and creativity that inform us what to do. And they emerge from the unseen spontaneously. From the unseen but already known. And this is the real joy of our living. This process that's always working, that doesn't show itself until the right moment. These days, in the modern world, especially the last 10 years or 20 years, we have become very used to obtaining answers to our questions very quickly through technology, of course. We get answers very quickly through very carefully worded searches online. And that's good. That's very helpful. It's very useful. When we do that, we can contribute to our knowledge, we can contribute to our understanding, and we can save time solving problems. But there is a downside. Every advance in technology has an unintended consequence. In this case, when we get used to doing searches to get our answers, we develop an expectation of being able to obtain very fast and very precise answers from outside ourselves. And we become impatient when the answer doesn't come quickly. The problem with having this technology available to us, the problem with becoming too reliant on it, we will forget how to be patient and just sit with our question and our concern and just watch it and see what the answer is or see what's needed. The problem is we will forget how to trust our non-thinking process. And when that happens, we lose ourselves. So our lives are infinitely wide open and they are unstructured. And amazingly diverse. Our work is constantly changing. Our social relationships are constantly shifting. Our lifestyles are always changing. The things that interest us are always changing. So we cannot design some kind of system to prepare ourselves for our life. We cannot design a set of algorithms in order to engage in a world of extreme openness and extreme change. If we rely too much on a systematic approach to life, we will spend our whole lifetime wondering what our role is. We will always be wondering how to apply the system. And where is that algorithm that I need right now? We will forget what our life is. So we need to trust our unstructured and unsystematic mind that can express itself when it is quiet and observant, when it is expansive and not stubborn. And when it is not concerned only about its own well-being. In other words, to trust our mind that places confidence in its own experiences. And from that wisdom, knows what to do without words. I think it's very much like the first year of our life. In that first year of life, you know, first 2 years, a baby bonds to its mother through body language, through touch, through sounds, and through the eyes. In other words, in those first months, the baby is actively taking in everything without words and without thinking. This is our heritage. All of us do this. It turns out this is the most important way we connect with each other. It's the way a baby connects with its mother, and it's the most important way we connect with each other throughout our whole life. So Dogen says, non-thinking. And what he means is, pay attention, take it all in, and you will always know what to do for each other. You know, this Zendo, any Zendo, the gift, the gift of the Zendo is not in words. It is in the silence that it offers us.